You are welcome to the broadcast of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International. In this broadcast, join International Crusade and Conference Speaker, Teacher, Senior Pastor, Apostle, General Overseer and Presiding Prelate of the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International, Bishop Akintayo Samjoli.
I announce to you, whatever was to follow you, that is not from God, it will not follow you, it will not follow your children.
His teachings and ministries have brought deliverance and transformation to many lives and families across the nation and beyond. Receive God's word with faith in your heart and watch your life move from glory to glory.
Now, this morning, for the sake of our topic, being traced easily, I'll call today's message, "The Lord Will Help You." The Lord will help you. Now, go with me to the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 26 and read verse 15. The Bible says, "And he made engines and invented by cunning men to be on the towers and upon the bulwarks, to shoot arrows and great stones withal. And his name spread far abroad, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong. For he was marvelously helped till he was strong." Now, let me make this statement, that the help of God is a game changer. When we talk of game changers, we're talking about when something is going in a certain direction, contrary or away from what you know or from what you desire to happen. Something is going against you more or less. Something is not working in your favor. Now, when things are working against you in a match, in a race, in a competition, and then you introduce something that brings a change, it is called a game changer. For example, we've had situations in election periods. I remember at some point, you know, let's look at some international figures. It was the candidate McCain and Obama that were in the election race. And because of global situations at the same point, McCain was doing well until there was a certain change and a certain issue with the global economy. And then you find out that Obama became more relevant. And that was a game changer for Obama to become president. And today, we are looking at the help of God being a game changer for you. I don't care who is ahead. I don't care who is having dominion over us. I don't care what circumstances are squeezing us. All what we need is for God to help us. When God helps you, the thing will change in your favor. When God helps us, circumstances will tip fully in our favor. Today, we are asking God to help us. May God help us in every way. May God help us in our finances, in our studies, in our relationship with God, in our service to Him, in the work of ministry. We need the game changer to change things for us. So we find out here was a certain man who became king, and Uzziah was helped by God, and he was able to accomplish great things as you read through the chapter. But all of it is because he was helped by God. And what is interesting, one of the things I want us to see is that when God helped Uzziah, he calls those who are around him to become wiser, innovative, to become inventors, to become creative. They became strong. Things worked in the favor of those around Uzziah. But remember, it was Uzziah that God was helping. And all those around Uzziah received help from what God had brought to him. Today, may God help us in a way that our family members would partake of that help. May God help us in a way that our friends, our neighbors, the body of Christ would partake of that help. We need God's help that would change our circumstances and that would make people around us become more productive. Hallelujah. When God helped Uzziah, the Bible says that God made men around him to become cunning inventors. Men around Uzziah became inventors. They began to receive wisdom on how to do things. The Bible says he made in Jerusalem engines invented by cunning men. He made that is under Uzziah's authority, under Uzziah's reign. Engines were made, but the Bible says they were invented by cunning men. I mean, these were the first missiles in those days, invented by cunning men, shooting arrows, great stones, and Uzziah's name went abroad. Now, the end of the verse says there, in 2 Chronicles 26, verse 15. For he was not just helped, but marvelously helped till he was strong. Somebody lift your hands with me. Say, Father, please help me marvelously. He was not helped on a common level. He was not helped just like others. He was helped marvelously. And that caused his name to go abroad. That caused his fame to go abroad. Lord, help us marvelously. Help us in the ministry marvelously. Help us in our home marvelously. Lord, help. You see, people have depended on various things to make them strong. But when those things fail, they'll fail. Now, one thing we know is that if God is our helper, God will never fail us. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. In Isaiah 41, verse 14, that's an easy code to remember, 4114. Isaiah 41, verse 14. It says, fear not, thou warm Jacob, and ye men of Israel. I will help thee, said the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. When you speak of a worm, you speak of something that is defenseless, has no strength, has no might, no defense system, hasn't associated with the worms. The hedgehog has a defense system. Some insects have the defense system. The worm has no defense system. The worm has no strength. And God says, I'll help you. Some people think that you have got to be strong for God to help you. You know, and you know, we hear the saying from what book of scripture, I don't know. God helps those who help themselves. I've not found that in the Bible that I read. He says, you worm, Jacob, you've got no strength to help yourself. But then I would help you. May God help us in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, in the book of 1 Samuel 7, verse 1 to 7, what we dealt with in the Word of God last night, I encourage you not to miss services. I encourage you to be in God's presence. You find out that the people came to Samuel, the prophet, the priest and prophet, because they needed help. He was the judge. He was like a king, priest, and prophet. Now, the Ark of God had been in the land of the Philistines for 7 months and then now came into Israel for another 20 years. and nothing good had happened, neither in the home in which the ark of God was, nor in the life of the Philistines. Nothing good had happened. I mean, in the life of all Israel. And they came to God and they cried unto God that God will help them. And Samuel came in and gave them conditions for this help. Because you see, in the account just read about this man who was helped by God, Uzziah, the very next verse is that when he became strong, he turned his heart away from God. And that was his end. That was his defeat. After all the testimony you've read in that chapter, when he became strong, his heart was lifted up against God. You know, we have seen it and we see it day by day in church. People whom God has helped, when they become strong, they turn their heart on God. Now, in this passage, in 1 Samuel 7, when they came to Samuel for help, when they came crying to God, Samuel told them this. There's some conditions. Now, if you return to the Lord, number one, do it with all your heart. If you're coming to God for help, do it with all your heart. Don't let your heart be divided. Don't let your focus be divided. There are people today who are coming from different religions, from Islam, from Buddhism, some from atheism, don't believe that God exists. And they come. They come because they've heard of somebody's testimony. They've been told of how God helped somebody. And some come from what is called Christianity, but it's not Christianity. The Bible calls it a form of godliness. God looks at the way many people are serving him and he calls it in the word of God a form of godliness. And they think they're godly. I pray that we will not deceive ourselves by having a form of godliness, but that we would be truly godly. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And not deny the power of it. That verse is from 2 Timothy 3, verse 5. It says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, the transformation power thereof, the power of holiness thereof, the power of the supernatural thereof. They do not live by the power of sanctification. They just declare, oh, we believe in God and we serve God. It's a form of godliness. Now, so here were these people. They came to God. They came to Samuel, the prophet, the priest. They said, pray for us. But then Samuel looked at them and realized that these people have the form of godliness, but not godliness itself. And they need to make a change. And Samuel had to address the issue in their lives. If you come to God, number one, come with all your heart. Come genuinely. And then he says to them, condition number two, put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you. Number three, prepare your hearts unto the Lord. Number four, serve him only. Condition number one, he said, when you come to God, do it with all your heart. Do it with all your heart. Number two, he said, put away strange gods and Ashtaroth. Now, as you see later on, when you speak of Ashtaroth in the next verse, it says that the children of Israel did put away Baalim and Ashtaroth and serve the Lord only. Ashtaroth is a Zidonian god of fertility. And Baal was believed to be his male counterpart, his male partner. And there are various forms of Baal. And when you look at the verse from that one, it's called Baalim, as in plural. Now, here's what it says. Put away the strange gods. So the people who were coming to God, they only had a form of godliness because they had strange gods in their life. Well, strange gods that people tend to have these days are the people that you look onto, people that control you, people that tell you what to do, people that take the place of God's authority in your life. They have become gods. People that influence you, people that persuade you, tell you where to worship, You say, no, I have a mind of my own. No. You're responding to somebody's influence, somebody's words, somebody's demonic example and control of your life. And you've become something else. You're controlled by money. We are looking at the gods of the Israelites and the gods, or the strange gods rather, that the Israelites borrowed from different nations. But you must understand that today in Christianity, we also have taken different gods. Different gods. You cannot come to God during the week. You cannot be a part of services. You cannot join the devotional. Your sleep has become a god. Money making has become a god. Your education has become a god. You claim to be a Christian. Who rules your time? Who has more of your time? The king of Simon. Simon says, hey, let's hold on. Stop all this rubbish. Stop talking as though God hates you, as though God is against you. The problem is not with God. It is with you. Seek him with all your heart. Number one. Number two, put away the strange gods that are among you. Number three, prepare your heart. Walk upon your heart. Get out bitterness. Get out lust. Get out deception. Walk upon your heart. Get away lukewarmness, complacency, laziness, distractions. Walk upon your heart. And then he says here, and serve him only. Don't come to church today and go to mosque tomorrow. Don't partake of the communion today and eat of all kinds of food tomorrow. No. Serve God and serve him only. Don't serve God and go back to secret society. Donate your money to things that are totally against the gospel of Christ. Serve him only. And then he concludes. The result is that he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines. He will help you. He will fight for you. God is not to be blamed. God wants to help. But what have we done to open the door to God's help? What have we done? What are we doing? And Samuel said, when you do those things, verse 5, gather all Israel to Mizpah. So when you put your heart in place, gather the people of God. It is important that you never forget that in as much as you can pray in your house, you must gather in God's presence, not just once a week. The disciples, that's how they walked in great power. They were consistent in their personal fellowship and they're consistent in corporate fellowship. They gathered together in church service, gathered together in the covenant families, and then gathered together also in your homes. Right now, my hope is that as we do this devotion time, I am not in your home or in your house. My hope is that we are actually gathering together. We're actually networking homes and families as you are gathered together in God's presence. Hallelujah. And then Simon says, when you gather together, I will pray for you. I will intervene. I will come in. I will cry unto God for you when you've met those conditions and then you've gathered together. Then I will pray for you. You find that Samuel, when as they gathered together, the Israelites, I mean Egyptians, the Philistines, when they heard of it, they came, they mobilized themselves in large numbers. Watch this all the time, that Israel was worshiping false gods and doing things. The Philistines did not gather against them. They knew it was powerless. They knew it was their own gods that they were calling upon, and they knew it would not work for them. All the time they were living in wickedness, the Philistines were not bothered. But the moment they began to seek the face of God and to obey Samuel, the Philistines said, we must fight against them quickly. That's why you find out today, churches are being stoned. People are attacking churches. The same people live in the community. Nobody bothers with them. But the moment they begin to pray, there's offense. There's offense. Because they know the power of prayer. And the power of, you know, purification. When we come before God in repentance and ask God to purge our lives, people think it's an old gospel, it's an out-of-date, you know, an outdated message. It is not. It is a message of the hour. Sanctification, holiness, purity, repentance. These things bring in, invite the power of God in an awesome way. And that's why you find out the Philistines went to battle. They say, are they gathered? They're praying. They've repented. Attack them quickly. But they did not know that God was swifter than them. And the people introduced the sacrifice. That's why I tell you every morning, give an offering to God. Join in the prayer. As Samuel began to offer the sacrifice, God found that from heaven against them. God fought against the Philistines. God smote them. God defeated them. God scattered them. This morning, I want you to take an offering, even right now as I'm talking. Hold your offering in your hand. But remember, for God to help you, before you get to the place of the offering, the place of the sacrifice, put away strange gods. Put away what must be away from your life. You cannot hold on to those things. Everything else takes the place of God in your life. And you expect God to help you. You bring your offering, you bring, you know, whatever gift to the altar. But your life remains the same. It doesn't work the way, dear sister. I know many people will not tell you this. Just bring your offering, let me receive it. Just bring your money. But go back and look at biblical pattern. Your offering is important. It does for you many things. But it is rendered powerless, impotent, when you have strange gods in your life.
I believe you've been tremendously blessed by this program with such powerful exposition of God's Word. Join the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International in our next broadcast. Also join us in worship at the Faith Cathedral 5 and 7 Victoria Street in Freetown on Sundays at 7 and 9 a.m. and Thursdays at 6 p.m. For prayers, counseling and testimony, please call +232 309007 or +232 77853207 or +232 77858151. This is the Living Word of Faith Outreach Ministries International.